Good morning, everybody. There is a phrase that we've said many times already today, and you know it, it's "He is risen." Now, that's right, the response to that is "He is risen indeed," by the way, in case you didn't know that. But this term, this phrase, means different things to a lot of different people. And this past week, there was actually a question that was presented to us. You see, remember a week ago, Notre Dame burned down, that great cathedral that was in France, a symbol of Christendom, in fact, burned to the ground. Now, inside, a lot of it was saved, a lot of those windows were saved and all those things, but the roof is gone, there was all kinds of damage. And the question that was arising was, what does this mean for Christianity? I don't know where you fall down on that, I don't know how you feel that is a symbol of anything. Personally, I don't really think it's a symbol of much because, you see, we have this phrase, this idea that He is risen. It means something different to everybody, but it is by far the most important thing that we can talk about as Christians. There was a guy in the Bible who actually doesn't get much screen time. He's not there for very much, and we don't even have a lot of his story. And so today I'm going to tell you a story how I think it happened, but I can guarantee you this is not in Scripture, all right? So it could have gone differently, but this is how I see it happening. Imagine a man for a moment sitting in a dark cell. It's stone on three sides. He only has bars in front of him. It is a holding cell in the governor's palace. The floor is wet because the floor is always wet in there. And he's sitting on a makeshift stool, waiting and waiting and waiting. He's been in there for days now. You see, he was brought to that cell because he was told by one of the guards he was awaiting his execution. His name was Barabbas. Now, Barabbas knows why he's there. He's no fool. You see, he started a riot not that long ago, a riot in which he wanted to whip up the crowd into a frenzy. He wanted to demonstrate and prove to these terrible Roman people that they were truly awful. And so he whipped up this crowd and he got them to march towards the governor's palace. And in this giant riot, a number of people were beaten and hurt. A few citizens died. Even a soldier was killed. And Barabbas knew he wasn't innocent. You see, he even had a gang that lived in the northern hills just beyond Jerusalem. And from that area, they would go and they would attack people all the time. They made a few Romans disappear, never to be heard from again. And the beautiful part about it, in his mind, was no one could prove that he did it. But this time he was caught. And the Romans made sure that he knew that he was going to be killed for his crimes. The Romans weren't very kind. He'd been beaten a few times. He knew the cruelty of the Roman whips. He knew exactly what he was facing. And so there he sat on that stool, biding his time until he heard his name being chanted. One of the guards the day before came to him and said, "By the way, Barabbas, we're going to hold a little ceremony out there in which we're going to offer two different prisoners, you and someone else. And who knows, maybe you'll be spared." And he laughed and laughed as he walked off. Barabbas knew what he was in for. Then this morning, another guard came to him. And just to needle it in, he said, "By the way, the other guy that you're going up against, he's a rabbi." And he laughed and laughed as he walked away. Barabbas knew his fate. Now, each one of us, we think we know how we can respond in any given situation. We think we know what we would do, and Barabbas is no different. He thought when he was facing his death that he would be brave and strong and he'd spit in the face of his guards, but he was scared. He sat there with a trembling hand, a tear in his eye, because you see, he knew what was about to happen. That crowd that was out there, that was a religious group. That was a group that served the temple and that came from that place. They're all a bunch of Pharisees and a bunch of religious leaders. Of course they're going to ask for their rabbi back. He knew in that moment that there was no one in the world that wanted him. And a tear welled up in his eye. And then he heard the rumble of the crowd out there. He couldn't make out the voices, of course. It was too far away, and he was too deep inside the palace, but he could hear the roar of the crowd. He knew that the ceremony was starting. And so he held his breath as he waited to hear his name, and sure enough, he could just faintly make out his name, Barabbas. Barabbas. Barabbas, he heard. And as he started to cry, he put his head down in his hands, thinking that this is it. These are the last few moments in the world. And then the shouting started getting louder and louder as he heard Barabbas, Barabbas being shouted. And then he heard another name being shouted. It was the name of Caesar. And he thought to himself, this is crazy. These people, they hate me so much that they're thanking Caesar that they get to kill me. And as his anger started to well up inside of him again, he heard another sound, a shuffling sound, a marching sound, the clank of a sword against armor. And he pushed his head up against the bars as he tried to see, and he couldn't quite, but slowly, slowly, he could see someone coming around the edge. And at first he sees one guard, and then he sees another guard, and then behind that guard, he sees another man. This man's been beaten as well. And by the look of it, he'd been freshly beaten. There was blood dripping off of him. He was hurt and in pain. And then the guard produced some keys and opened up the cell door. And he reached in and grabbed Barabbas by the shoulder and just wrenched him right out of the cell. Barabbas didn't know what to do. He just kind of followed suit and came forward and stood in front of them. And for a moment, the two men looked each other in the eye. Barabbas had just sunk to the lowest point in his life. His hope was gone. He knew he was a dead man. And there standing in front of him was someone who seemed in as much trouble as him. And in his eyes, he saw something else. He saw resolution. He saw confidence. He saw peace. This was something that Barabbas didn't feel. And then all of a sudden, the guard said something that he wasn't expecting. Come on, Barabbas. You're free to go. In that moment, he didn't know what to do with himself. He didn't know what to say. What do you mean I'm free to go? And then they shoved the other man into the cell and closed it behind him. And then they pulled Barabbas along. He didn't even have a chance to ask a question. He was pushed all the way through to the end of the hallway. And eventually, he gets out into the sunlight, which is too bright. He hasn't seen it in days. And as his eyes are trying to adjust, there's a crowd out there that starts to roar and cheer, shouting his name and praising Caesar. And this isn't what Barabbas wanted. All he wanted was for his people to be free, not to be subjects of Rome. And then they pushed him and shoved him down the stairs. He fell to the ground and picked himself up. And a few people helped pick him up and were cheering and clapping and patting him on the back. These were men and people that he had never seen before in his life. He doesn't know these guys. And he knows that these are all these religious people from the temple. And he knew it was all a show. And then he was allowed to go. Barabbas was a guilty man. A guilty man that truly was guilty, and everybody knew it. And Barabbas was given life. I wonder, when we say the words, "He is risen," can we appreciate that the same way Barabbas did on that day? An innocent man went to his death for someone who was truly guilty. You see, death is a constant theme in the Bible. Now, I know this is a little bit heavy this morning, and you probably came to church today thinking it was all going to be sunshine and rainbows, and we were going to be really excited together as a family and go off to lunch. But this is something we need to hear. Death is a constant theme in Scripture. In fact, death is presented as the big enemy in Scripture. Don't be mistaken. Satan's there, but he's not the big bad. The big bad is death. Why? Because death is something we all face. Death, no matter who you are, no matter where you've been, no matter what you've done, death is something you and I face today. We know it's coming. We know it's out there. Death was one of the consequences of sin in the very, very beginning. The first people didn't have to face that, and then they sinned, and God said, "They cannot contend with me forever." And he sent them out, and they weren't allowed to eat from the tree of life anymore, and death came into the world. Death is the enemy. That's what oppression truly is. Our sinfulness has brought us to this place. Sin, there is no escape. And remember those verses, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and the wages of sin are death. Those are two inescapable verses in the Scripture. It means that all of us face the same opponent, and armed on our own, we cannot escape it. And so we need an answer to death. You see, we believe in one who is risen. Paul describes it this way in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. If you have a Bible, I'd like you to open it to that and mark it there, because this is a very dense chapter. There's a lot going on in this chapter. And this is a church of people that are needing instruction on how to live Christian lives, what to do in response to Jesus being risen. And even back then, people said, yeah, you know what? I don't really believe that someone can rise from the dead. That's a pretty big statement, isn't it? So Paul is telling them this. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection from the dead? If there's no resurrection from the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him if, in fact, the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ hasn't been raised either. And if Christ hasn't been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. Then those who have also fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people to be most pitied. Do you hear what he's saying here? If Jesus didn't in fact rise from the dead, if Jesus was not raised and came out of that tomb, if that story about the women going to the tomb and not finding him there, and then him appearing to the disciples and them freaking out over it, and then him sending them out into the world, if that's not true, then nothing we're doing here matters today. It doesn't matter at all, because you see, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and the wages of sin is death, and death has won. But if Jesus was raised from the dead, if Jesus truly did miraculously come out of that grave, that's a different story. Because if he didn't, we're in trouble. In fact, we become liars. Not just liars to ourselves, but liars to the people out there. And not just liars to the people out there, liars about God, Paul says. Because we said that God said that this happened, that God in fact truly did this thing. The point here cannot be overemphasized. Christ rose from the dead. You know, of all the philosophies in Scripture, of all the philosophies in the world, of all the people, of all the worldviews, of all the religions that are out there, Jesus Christ is unique. He's unique in this way because we say that there is a historical fact that Jesus rose from the dead. That we're able to go back and check, that we're able to verify that Jesus did in fact rise from the dead. And yet today we have the same problem that we did back then. There are people that say that it couldn't possibly have happened. Why? Because people don't just rise from the dead. Right? In fact, we have the philosopher Nietzsche who said, God is dead. And then we had this whole rise of people that said, just give us a few more years and we will liberate ourselves from religions entirely. It's called secularization, that without God we'd be so much better off if we could just get rid of that God nonsense. And in fact, 50 years ago, sociologists believed that we would be done with all this by now, that we'd be well beyond God. But something has happened. People were convinced that God was on the way out, and scholars had bought into this theory. And yet, there's a scholar by the name of Peter Berger. I don't expect you to know this guy, and he'll probably stick in your head because he has the last name Berger. But in 2011, at an academic conference, Steven Berger, one of the world's leading atheists, said that almost everyone in the sociology field has changed their minds about God being on the way out, about secularization, simply because that is what the evidence demands. He said that if you look at the contemporary world, The real situation is that most of the world is as religious as it has ever been. In fact, all the major world religions have experienced a resurgence in recent years, not a decline. And despite what's happening in North America, despite what we think or what we might feel because the TV is reporting it a certain way, church is not going anywhere. Jesus has not left North America. In fact, there are more Christians today than there have ever been. God is not dead. Probably the most influential British philosopher of religion in the last half century is a guy by the name of Richard Swinburne. Again, I don't expect you to know who this guy is, but I just want you to know he is well learned. He has sat and read more books than all of us in this room combined. He has probably written more books than anybody else that I know of. And in 2003, he published a book entitled The Resurrection of God Incarnate. And in that book, he concludes that on the available evidence today, that there is a 97% probability that Jesus truly and completely, miraculously rose from the dead. We don't just spout this out and say, oh, believe it, cover your eyes, plug your ears, and just hope that Jesus rose from the dead. There is evidence, real evidence. If you'd like to know more about that, I'd be happy to sit down with you and walk you through it. I have things you can read. I have things to show you. But Jesus truly is who he claimed to be, and this is what our entire religion hinges on. This is what our whole faith hinges on. So many Christians are afraid to talk about their faith because they feel like they don't know enough. They feel like those people out there are so much smarter and so much better than they are that they can't defend what they know. Ladies and gentlemen, it all comes down to this. If Jesus Christ rose from the dead, he is Lord and Savior. Paul continues. He says, but Christ indeed, in verse 20, has been raised from the dead. He is the first fruits of all of those who have fallen asleep. What that means is he is the first to be raised, that he is the one that has conquered death. For since death came through a man, remember, Adam and Eve sinned and death came into the world. Since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. But each in turn, Christ the first fruits, then when he comes, those who belong to him. Could it be that you and I have been called into something far more miraculous than Jesus coming back from the dead? Could it be that not only do we believe in one who demonstrated the power of God through feeding miraculously and walking on water and doing incredible miracles, not only do we believe in one who demonstrated the love of God through his relationships to prostitutes and tax collectors and sinners and those who were sick, not only do we believe in one who showed the provision of God in the way that he served other people selflessly, that he wore a crown of thorns, that he himself died for those who hated him. Not only do we believe in one who showed the creativity of God, in the way that he would describe the world to people, in the stories that he would tell, in the silly things that he would do. But we believe in one who has mastered the ultimate bad guy, death. You see, the one who can conquer death is God. Because if death wins, God is not God. There is something more powerful than him. But if death can be overcome, the one who overcomes it is God. And we believe, in fact, at the core of our being, at the core of our faith, we believe that not only did Jesus Christ rise from the dead, that you and I get to participate in resurrection ourselves. Because we believe that there are two kinds of resurrection. First, the kind that happens in us. We say that we die with Christ. That means that we put to death the old self so that something new can live, because that old person was awful and terrible and a victim of sin and oppressed by sin and a slave to sin, but we want to be someone new, and Jesus says, I will live in you, and we can do that. That's the first resurrection. But then there's a second one. You see, death doesn't win. And you and I, this is not all that there is. Paul says it like this: for the perishable, in verse 23, or 53, the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable. You and I are perishable. Our bodies can fall apart. Our bodies can die, but we need to be put on something new. For the perishable can clothe itself with something imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true: death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is law. But thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. This is our hope. This is what we are living for. This is what we are enacting every single day. We have been raised to life that we may live a wonderful, beautiful, amazing life, a powerful life in Him. And this life isn't over here. It carries on. There is more to it than that. Because you see, death cannot win. Jesus has been raised. He is alive. He hasn't gone anywhere. In fact, He lives with us now. And He has imparted His Spirit on us that we could experience this resurrection over and over and over again. Would you pray with me? Lord and Father, I want to thank You. I want to thank You for what You've done. Without You, Lord, where would we be? Without Your calling in our life, what would we do? Father, for those who don't know You, I pray that Your Spirit is talking to them right now. Lord, that we can experience this resurrection that You speak of. Lord, we've discovered that there is no problem, there is no opposition, there is nothing, no sin that is in our lives that can take us down, that can hold us down, that You cannot deal with. Lord, there is no opponent, whether mortal or immortal, that You cannot defeat. And so, Lord, we just ask that You can speak to us, that You can help us to trust in You, that we can place our faith solely in You because You rose from the dead. Lord, give us the strength to carry on. Help us to share each other's burdens. Help us to know who You are and what You have done. It's in Jesus' wonderful and holy name we pray. Amen.